Hey, everybody, it's me, Dr. Fuck from Thrasher Die, with a little bit of a hoarse throat because I was deep throating cock. No, that's not true. All you homos, put it back in your pants. I was just kidding. I did a show the other night where I sang with three bands, and my voice is a little hoarse, you know. And anyway, so I'm here with another wacky edition of the Rock and Metal Combat Podcast with my buddy Ian and Terrence. How you guys doing?
All right, I got a good day drunk on. I'm ready to go.
And my balls are completely empty from busting two nuts on some girl that just left half an hour ago.
So, I didn't know your mom was in town.
Hey. It was my aunt, okay?
Oh, I like her.
Yeah, who doesn't?
Your uncle.
Anyway, so this week it's Nickafasanathan. That's actually a nice fucking show backwards. No, it's not. I don't even know what the hell I said backwards. We're going to review what many considered the greatest Anthrax album of them all. Many, but not me. I don't think so. As a matter of fact, I find this album to be quite overrated.
Spoiler alert!
Well, you know, I figure, you know, you guys are going to want to know, especially you purists of this album, want to know why I would say something as stupid as this album being overrated. Well, stick around and I'll give you my opinion. And it is my opinion, all right? So this week we're talking about Among the Living from Anthrax. Okay? I guess I'll start this off with a little setup. How I discovered Anthrax was actually on a compilation album. One of my favorite compilation albums that I can't remember the name of it now. But it has, I got turned on by a lot of bands on that album, like Tokyo Blade, If Heaven Is Hell is on that album. The Rods, Born to Rock is on that album. A killer band called Thunderfire, who's an awesome band you all should look into, a very obscure band. They're on the album. And Metal Thrashing Mad, All Fistful of Metal is on that album. And I ran out and bought it because of that one song. And to this day, I still hail Fistful of Metal as the best Anthrax album of them all. And then I would say the second best would be a tie between Spreading the Disease and the Armed and Dangerous EP. That, to me, is Anthrax pinnacle. Those three releases are my favorite Anthrax. And then after that, I liked a few songs off some albums, including Among the Living, but we will get into that later. So I want you guys to tell us how you guys discovered Anthrax.
First I heard of Anthrax would probably be seeing the video for Indians on Headbangers Ball. And man, they just got me right there. Ran out and got it, you know, probably right after it came out. And, you know, that was a golden age for the thrash, because around that time, you know, you had Puppets had been released. You know, you had Rain and Blood by Slayer. You had Peace Sells by Megadeth. I mean, the big four were really starting to make their presence felt. And, man, I took the album home, fell in love with it, and I've been a major Anthrax fan ever since. I love all incarnations of Anthrax. I love I love the original Fistful of Metal with Neil Turbin. I love the John Bush era. You know, my favorite is the Joey Belladonna era, but I've stuck with them through thick and thin, and they never let me down. I love Anthrax.
I gotta say, Fistful of Metal to me was Anthrax at its purest. That's before they, you know, see, Anthrax, to me, they're just bandwagon jumpers. They have been, even with the thrash. That first album, even though it did have some thrash elements, it was more an accept Iron Maiden type thing, a little sped up. But till they really started hanging out with Metallica, I started to hear Metallica, especially on Among the Living. And when we get into those tracks, I will even point out this is total Metallica worship. So let's start it off. I'll start it off. And speaking of Metallica worship, the title track, Among the Living. Now, at the time, we had Master of Puppets and Ride the Lightning, where it had kind of like the little intro, and then it would go into the crunchiness of the song. Well, that's what Among the Living does. It starts with the, you know, the little riff, and then it goes into da da na na gun 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 gun. Wish it was Metallica. Da da na da gun 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 gun. Got this from Hetfield. Da that yeah, it's total fucking Metallica worship. But then they did do a little twist and throw in a little bit of that New York hardcore into it that they were into. And it fused them all really good on this song. So this song, I actually like Among the Living. I like the title track. I think it's a really cool song. I love that I am the walking dude. Even though there is like bandwagon jumping on the song, I can't deny the greatness that is the title track, Among the Living.
I love Among the Living. Great way to start this out. A classic track, a great fucking great album opener and a great live opener. Lyrically, you know, it's Walking Dude. It's all about The Stand by Stephen King, which so many Anthrax songs were based on Stephen King novels and short stories. And this is just, bam, out the gate. A great way to start it. Ralph did bring up some great points because it does. There is a Metallica sound in it, but it is very East Coast at the same time, and I love East Coast thrash. You know, they you know, Nuclear Assault, Anthrax, Overkill. There's a uniqueness to it that's different from, you know, the Bay Area thrash sound, and it's definitely got more of a punk vibe. And love it. You know, it's always going to be in the set because it's a great song. Next one is Caught in a Mosh, and I'll start this one out. This is an all-time classic. This is a thrashterpiece, if you will. Just great musically, great lyrically. Just really reminds me, you know, of the thrash movement at that time. And, you know, that's where you separated, you know, who was, like, you know, just getting into cock rock and who was a real fucking headbanger. Because the fucking headbangers were listening to this shit. And awesome lyrics, awesome vocals by Joey Belladonna, which I think is the best vocalist out of the Big Four. I love, you know, and it helped me get into thrash because of his vocals. Because that dude can sing the fucking phone book, and it was neat to have those kind of vocals with that kind of power and aggression. And this is an all-time classic.
Oh, I love this song. I've always loved Caught in a Mosh. They got a lot of shit for this because they didn't really invent the word mosh, but a lot of people think they did. And I remember seeing interviews where Scott Ian was very like frustrated, saying, "Oh God, I didn't make up that word." And people don't really call it mosh anymore; they just say pit, going in the pit, you know. But you know, actually, the song has nothing to do about moshing. It's just kind of like what Skid Row did later on with Slave to the Grind, I guess. Or maybe not. I don't know. I know it's like something of being caught in a situation. But then it also has, like, you know, it's slamming somebody, you know, talking to you, like clapping with one hand. I love it. One thing I love about Anthrax is those backing vocals are kind of unique. That, you know, that Scott Ian's got a cool heavy voice. Like if you listen to Protect and Survive, they do also a cover of Celtic's Frost, Throne Emperor, where Scott Ian sings. I like Scott Ian's voice. He's got like a heavy type voice. Caught in a Mosh, I really dig it. It's not a bad song at all. It's actually one of their best songs, and ever since the Among the Living album came out, they have always played this song live. It's a fan favorite, it's a live favorite, and Caught in a Mosh rules, dude. Great fucking song.
One thing I'd like to add to that real quick, is as far as the title, Caught in a Mosh, I saw an interview where they said one of their roadies, they saw him backstage, the dude was all like beat to shit, you know, got the shit knocked out. I'm like, what the fuck happened to you? And he was trying to cross the venue in the middle of the show, and he said he got caught in the mosh. And that's where, and then they came up with the title.
There you go. So, yeah, it's a great classic song. One of their best songs, without a doubt. Very popular, and to me, when it comes to popular Anthrax songs, I always never agree, but this one is the exception. This is a popular Anthrax song that I fucking love. I hate this song. I really? Yes. And and I know there's a lot of people out there that like Thrash or Die and are really upset with me right now. And they're like, oh, fuck this guy. He doesn't like I Am the Law. And I Am the Law is very popular. I'll tell you why I don't like this song. I just find it hokey, stupid, the whole Judge Dredd thing. Let me put it this way. I like Sylvester Stallone's Judge Dredd more than this song. How do you like those apples, Ian?
Ouch. This is cool that you hate it that much, because I fucking love it. And
oh, how shocking.
And I am kind of responsible for this.
Oh.
Yeah. A lot of people don't know this. Around this time, I used to work for Megaforce Records. And, you know, I was trying to help Anthrax break big. And I said, hey, this Stallone movie is going to come out, you know. And maybe you guys could write a song about it. You know, they're like, what? I'm like, the guy that just did Cobra, you know, is going to make this movie. And, you know, I'm like, he's going to be like, oh, look. You know, I'm like, you need to write a song, you know, where you're like, oh, look. And they did. And it, you know, and I feel bad because the timing was off, because the movie was stuck in development hell. It didn't end up coming out for like about another fucking 8 or 10 years. But they already had the song written, already put it on the album. And I think it's fucking awesome. I Am the Law fucking rules. Next, we go into Enolic fucking Sisson, or however the fuck you say that. Nice fucking life. This song is about John Belushi. Scott Ian and Charlie Benante and a lot of the band were huge Belushi fans. But Anthrax was very, you know, I'm surprisingly I like them, because they're not much drinkers and they're not much druggers. And this was their, you know, song that was anti, you know, living that kind of lifestyle that's going to lead you to an early grave. And normally I hate preachy shit like that, but this is a song where I just, you know, tune out the fucking lyrics because I'm drunk and enjoy the music. And I love the music to this, and it's a great song. It's a fun song, and you know, even though I don't agree with their fucking teetotaler bullshit, I still love NFL. What do you think, Ralph?
Best song on the album. Love the hell out of this song. I did know it was about John Belushi, but I totally forgot. Yeah, good thing you brought that up. I did forget it was about John Belushi. What a great song. What a great riff. And it's just, oh, I love this song, man. This is definitely a standout track on the album for me. NFL, what else can I say? It's a great mosher, too. I used to love slam dancing to this one when they would play this one live. To me, standout track on the album, favorite song, is NFL, Nice Fucking Life. Innenekafessen, that's, I believe, how you pronounce it.
Skeletons in the Closet. This is another Stephen King-based song. This is based on the novel Apt Pupil, which later became a movie. And not bad, but it's not on par with the rest. I wouldn't call it a bad song. It's filler, but it's good filler, in my opinion. That's about all I got for Apt Pupil. Skeletons in the Closet. What do you think, Ralph?
All right, should I say something that'll spoil the rest of the episode for me, or should I keep quiet about it?
You should keep quiet about it.
Okay, I'll keep
quiet.
Say it. No, I'll keep quiet about it. I love Skeleton in the Closet. Again, it's probably my second favorite. No, I would say it's one of my favorites on the album. I always loved this song, and the thing I love the most is, like, again, the backing vocals. I just like, in the closet. Any skeletons, any misfortune, hiding in the closet. I just love the hell out of this fucking song. To me, it is a standout track. And when I saw the Among the Living tour, which I technically really saw it twice, because they came back as the I Am the Man tour, but it was pretty much the same thing. It was pretty much the Among the Living tour, except they played Sabbath, Bloody Sabbath, to make it different. They didn't play Skeleton in the Closet either show. But, you know, then they did do the whole album on tour many, many years later, which I didn't get to see. So I've never seen Anthrax play Skeleton in the Closet, unfortunately. But it is one of the standout tracks for me, one of my favorite tracks on the album. is Skeletons in the Closet. Now let me be the one to flip the album over and put on the single and probably the most popular song off the album, Indians. I love when Scott Ian goes, "War Dance," and it goes into that riff. And you know what else I like about this song? Nothing else. That's the only thing I like about that song is the little middle section. The rest is just garbage to me. I'm sorry. Fuck Indians. Like, cry for the Indians? Cry for the Indians? What kind of thrash is that? All right. I don't like this song, but I like the middle mosh part. That's all I can say about it. Ian?
Wow. Boy, this makes my dick hard because I couldn't disagree with you more. This is probably my favorite Anthrax song of all time. I fucking love Indians. And, hey, wait till it's your turn, Terrence. Wake the fuck up. It talks about an important subject, which is Indians. They're not just there to service you at the convenience store or, you know, to answer, when you call and you need tech support. You know, our friends over in India, you need to be nice to them. And Indians is a fucking incredible fucking song. It is about India, right?
It's about Indians. The white man took the land.
Native Americans, you jackass.
Oh, well, shit, now I love it even fucking more.
Blackfeet, Cherokee.
Yeah. Oh, okay. I love it even more because I am like a half of 3/4 Native American myself, so now I really identify with it because, Ralph might know. I don't know if Terrence knows. I'm like half 1/16 Pecari Indian. We used to walk around in the woods, smoke a peace pipe, and say, "Hey, where the fuck are we?"
You're American. You know, stop with this. I'm sick of these people saying, "Well, I'm half this, I'm half that." Where the hell were you born? America. That's your American. Like African Americans. Hey, man, I'm not racist, but most people that walk around saying they're African American never been to Africa. Oh, I'm supposed to be Cuban American because my parents are Cuban? No, I'm American and I'm damn proud of it. And if you're not proud and you're going to put American second, then go to whatever country you put in front of America, you twat.
Well, I was born here, so I guess I am a Native American.
I'm as an American as the American Indian, because we were all born here. And it's not my fault Christopher Columbus came here and slaughtered Indians, all right? It's not my fault that black people came over here and were slaves. I wasn't alive, and neither was anybody listening to this right now. You weren't alive back then, so do not take the fault of your ancestors. Thank you.
I identify with it because I'm Native American because, you know, I can't handle my fire water, and sometimes I take things back to people. I don't do good with smallpox, and I do live on a reservation, and I work at a casino.
You lying sack of shit.
My great 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 grandfather took a piss in the North Pole, so I guess that makes me an Eskimo American. Fuck all that shit. I'm American and damn proud of it.
Yeah, you look like a fucking Eskimo. One world, just said it's one world, man. You know, we can't, you know, it's very of the times, you know, talks about Russia in there. So I'm thinking this song was probably inspired by Rocky IV, then, you know, Red Dawn and other, you know, Red Menace movies.
What do you think of ADI horror of it all? Ralphie boy.
I hate it. What do you think, Ian?
I think it's a deep cut on the album. I enjoy it. ADI, which stands for Arabic Douche Intro. No shit.
Wow, I didn't know the damn stuff was Arabic.
Yeah. Well, no, they're referring to, you know, the little ditty. But but that's what they called his little. I'm sure fucking Scott Ian called, you know, coined that phrase.
Wait, are you being serious? Actually?
Yes, I'm being dead serious. That's what ADI, Arabic Douche Intro.
Really?
Yes. And then it goes into Horror of It All, which I think is a deep cut on the album, because, you know, as with all reviews, I went back and listened to this a couple times. And it's one of the lesser known ones, but I was like, man, why didn't I you know, catch this more when I listen to this album. I was definitely more of a, you know, aside from Indians, I was more of a first side to this album. But I really enjoyed this. And that I mean, that's about all I got. You know, it's definitely a grower, but I really enjoyed it. What do you think, Terrence? Or, I'm sorry, Ralph, what do you think?
He already gave his opinion.
I just said I hated it, but let me get a little more into it. I just find it just boring. You know what it is? It's like, I was really a huge fan of Anthrax before this album came out. And they were like, you know, like I said, Fistful of Metal, Armed and Dangerous, Friend of Disease. I like every song on all those records, with the exception, but it doesn't really count. The God Save the Queen cover was eh. But, you know, I mean, that doesn't really count since it is a cover. But, you know, that had Raise Hell on it and Armed and Dangerous, and I think there was another one. I liked everything they were doing, and then when it came to this album, especially side two, I was like, God, this is just, I don't know, man, it's just so unmemorable. And I did listen to this album in its entirety like a week ago, and it's still like, I'm listening to part of it all, One World, and thinking to myself, man, I mean, I don't even remember these songs, and I'm listening to them now I know why. Because they're just so unmemorable for me. They're just whatever. And they never played them live back in the day. They did when they did this album in its entirety. Because for some reason, everybody points at this as their best album. But, yeah, I don't like One World at all.
A last song, Imitation of Life. This is actually a remake of an SOD track called Aren't You Hungry? And I definitely prefer the SOD track. This isn't bad, and I think it's a good way to end the album. Nothing wrong with it, but it's not one of the standout tracks. This album definitely could have benefited from a little different sequencing, I think, because the first side's way stronger. That could have staggered some of this shit. But I love Imitation of Life, and I love this album, and I love Anthrax, so let's hear Ralph complain about it.
Okay, yeah, you know I am. Like, I didn't want to give the spoiler away before when I said, should I spoil it before I say anything about Skeleton in the Closet? Because what I wanted to say was this is when the album ends for me. Skeleton in the Closet is like the rest of this album. It's just garbage. And this one, yes. Aren't You Hungry, which I did not know this was the music for Aren't You Hungry until many years later. I was so used to the USA from MOD version that's equally as kick-ass. But yeah, I heard them play this on a video, and then they did record it on Bigger Than the Devil. Yes, the music to this song benefits the lyrics to Aren't You Hungry really good. So I still would say the MOD version is better, but this version is light years away from Imitation of Life. Is just so fucking stupid with Robbie Bang and shit like that. It's just shitty. It's just a shitty song, and it's Anthrax trying to be a little silly and funny. And a lot of the Anthrax stuff when they were trying to be silly and funny back in the day is so goddamn dated. It's more dated than their stupid Bermuda shorts that they would play, because the thing about Anthrax back then, Terrence, you're drowning me out, buddy. The thing about Anthrax was back then, they were so desperate to be different than everybody else by wearing these stupid little shorts and like not singing about. See, and that, here's another thing I want to bring up about Anthrax, and nobody notices this shit about me, except me. Anthrax was very anti-satanic, anti-this, anti-that, because, and even on an MTV interview during the State of Georgia, they're like, even bashing bands that sing about Satan and this and that, and you would never, ever, ever see Anthrax give the sign of the horns in the 80s. Now all they do, every picture with Scott Ian, he's giving the sign of the horns. They got a goddamn pentagram as their like logo now. They call it the, what is it? Pentathrax.
Who gives a fuck?
It's called the Pentathrax, and they're all like, oh, and now now it's okay to be all this evil shit because, you know, black metal and all this shit. That's why I have a problem with Anthrax's, you know, jumping on like trends, you know? And now it's like, in the 80s, they would have never, ever used the pentagram. They would have never done the horns. None of that stuff. Now they do it all the time because it's so in. And they should be just damn right ashamed of themselves with their new image and shit like that. Let me just finish the Anthrax thing. I got to say, after this, it got even worse. State of Euphoria was just fucking horrible. That was like just a silly album, but it did have its moments. I like Be All, End All. And Now It's Dark was pretty good. And I actually like the real filler track called Schism. I actually like those. There's three songs I like on that album. Then came Persistence of Time, which was just garbage. Sound of White Noise was cool, but it wasn't Anthrax anymore. They should have changed the name of the band. I am a huge fan of John Bush, but I'm a huge fan of Armored Saint, which we should do an Armored Saint episode eventually. I like his voice way better than Joey Belladonna's, but I don't think in Anthrax he fit. Armored Saint, even Anthrax at their best, wasn't as good as Armored Saint, in my opinion. You know, that stuff, you know, then it got worse after that. I mean, I did like some of Stomp. I liked very little Volume 8 and the other two. Or the We Came For You All, whatever. Their last album was okay. It wasn't bad. I was actually impressed with the last album with Belladonna. Because Belladonna kind of like, he stepped to the plate and he did really good on the album. Though I don't think the album is that great as everybody thinks it is. But I thought Belladonna was really good on the album. And I like the song Indiana. I think that's a really cool tune. That's all I got to say about Anthrax, you know. And let you guys finish up what you think of Anthrax after Among the Living, guys.
I got to disagree with Ralph. I'm not a huge Fistful of Metal fan. I like it, but to me it's just so different and doesn't even sound like Anthrax that I know and love. Loved Armed and Dangerous. Loved Spread the Disease. I got to admit, Spread the Disease is a better album. There's tracks on Among the Living that I like better, but as an album, I love Spread the Disease. Nobody can really defend State of Euphoria. While I do love a lot of songs on that, there's way too much filler, but I totally disagree on Persistence of Time. I love Persistence of Time. It's an amazing fucking metal album. Attack of the Killer Bees, I think, is a great collection. And I love the John Bush era, especially Sound of White Noise. And I was impressed when I found out they got rid of Joey Belladonna, because he was my favorite thing about the band was that voice. But then I heard fucking Sound of White Noise, and particularly Only, and I was like, fucking hey, this is just incredible. A great, great album. And it's Stomp 442, and I believe that is a great fucking album. I think Stomp 442 is a great example of experimenting and changing without being a total sellout, like Load was, era of Metallica. I think Anthrax tried some new stuff, and in my opinion was successful, because I thought it still sounded good, even though it was different. Volume 8, not bad, but my least favorite of the Bush era. I love We Come For You All. I think that was a fantastic fucking album. The one where they redid, you know, all the Belladonna tracks was all right. I mean, I love Bush. Anything John Bush sings, I'm going to fucking enjoy. And the last album that they just put out, Worship Music with Belladonna, yeah, I think is incredible. I'm getting off those nuts. I know Ralph doesn't think it's as good as what everybody says. I think it is. I think it's great. I can't wait for the next one. And they say it's going to be even heavier, and I hope it is. I think it's going to be awesome. I love Anthrax, all eras.
I want to throw in a couple things. Yeah, I want to go back to Stomp 442, which I do think it is a good album. It's much better than everybody like slams it a lot. And, I love the song Tester, and In a Zone was cool. Random Acts of Violence was awesome. And I really love the last track, Bear,
which I love Bear. Love that song.
It's a beautiful ballad, acoustic, so out of left field, something you wouldn't expect that from Anthrax. And yeah, I agree with you, and they experimented with it, but they kept it heavy, and at that time it wasn't a good idea to keep it heavy. And another thing that I have to bring up, even though I'm not the biggest John Bush era fan, to me, like, other than Fistful of Metal and, you know, Spreading and Armed and Dangerous, my favorite Anthrax was the B-sides they did with John Bush, which I have a compilation of. And a lot of it is covers, and a lot of it are original songs, like Poison My Eyes, Noise Gate. These are great fucking songs, and they did awesome versions of Watching You and Lover All I Can.
I agree with you 1,000% there, Ralph. That collection of all the B-sides and covers is awesome. Amazing.
Awesome stuff. Dethrone Emperor. They even do Next to You from the Police, which is Frank Bello singing it. That collection. Oh, and my favorite cover of them all, the Cowboy song from Thin Lizzy. Incredible version. They do Offbeat the Same from Cheap Trick. It's just a wide variety of killer songs. London from the Smiths
is incredible.
Unbelievable.
Incredible.
That, to me, is like that type of, those songs are just incredible. And when actually I listen to John Bush B-side from Anthrax more than all the other stuff, even though I do prefer, you know, the first three releases. But yeah, that's something I had to bring up. We didn't bring up also the last one, which was a covers album with Smoking from Boston, Big Eyes, Cheap Trick, a Journey song, Keep On Running, I believe it was.
Yeah, Keep On Running.
And what else did they do on that one? There was another cover, wasn't there? It was. It wasn't that.
Jailbreak by Thin Lizzy, I think.
Yeah, which is kind of like, Jesus, really, that one? You know, sure. But still, I mean, it's not a bad song, but Thin Lizzy, man, you should have, like, dug in a little deeper like you did with Cowboy Song and did a version of, I don't know, like, Cold Sweat or something. But, that's all I got to say about Anthrax. Another great thing is Charlie and Frankie Bello are just amazing at what they do. What a great bass player and what an amazing drummer. And Charlie is also an amazing guitar player, which he does a lot of the guitar work on Stomp 442 and the other stuff where Dimebag did some solos on those albums. Very talented musicians. And the last thing I want to say about Anthrax, which is a positive thing, was I was completely blown away when I went to the theater to see the Big Four, which is only a block away from my house. They actually screened it. It was 4 hours I was in the theater to see the Big Four. It was a satellite thing, and which now is out on Blu-ray. And Anthrax kicked ass that day. I mean, they came out and they fucking ruled. They were like, kind of like the underdogs, and they very much impressed me with that performance they did at the Big Four that is available now on Blu-ray and DVD. And I highly suggest you guys check that shit out. It's fucking awesome. And that's all I got to say about Anthrax. A very negative toward Anthrax to the episode, but I wanted to end it in a positive note, how I really feel about them. There's a lot of good things about Anthrax, and I wouldn't say among the living, most of it is not what I would consider a positive about Anthrax, but there is a lot of stuff I love about them. And that's it, right, guys? You guys done with your Anthrax discussion, right?
Yeah, and now I would like to I'd like to talk about some other picks, some other stuff that we're interested in that we think the fans should check out. Band I would like to bring up, they're called Uncle Acid and the Deadbeats. They're from Cambridge, England, and just amazing band. Very much the Sabbath vibe, you know, that drugged out drone, fuzzy guitars. You know, very influenced by the Hammer horror pictures. That plays in big into their live set. But an amazing band. They opened up for Sabbath on their European tour, but now they're doing a U.S. tour, and they're playing like maybe only 8 shows, and most of them are sold out. But look them up, and if they're anywhere by where you live, please go check this band out. Uncle Acid and the Deadbeats, an amazing band. What do you think, Ralph? What do you got to suggest?
Send me some of that, Ian. I have heard about this band. I haven't heard of it yet, though.
Amazing. Forwarded to me as well.
I'll send it to you.
I want to talk about a movie. There's so much music I like to bring up too, but I want to bring up a movie that somebody turned me, well, somebody asked me to check out, and I love this movie to death. It's called Black Dynamite. I don't know if you guys seen this movie.
Love it. Love it.
What a hilarious. It's a, like a black exploitation movie, but it was just so, I mean, it's probably the best movie I think been made since, I don't know, since the 70s or 80s, you know? I know that's talking big, but as far as comedy goes, I put it up in my top five favorite comedies of all time. Ian, do you know what year that movie came out? It's not that old.
I want to say that was 2009. And then what I just saw, as a matter, it's funny you say that, because this morning, unfortunately, I was in fucking Walmart, and I saw they had Black Dynamite, the series, volume one. And I couldn't tell. It was behind the glass, and I couldn't get to it. But I don't know if they do, like, a cartoon version of it now, like an adult cartoon version. But, no, it is an amazing, funny movie. If you like all things 70s and blaxploitation, it's very tongue-in-cheek, but really, really good. I mean, Ralph hit the nail on the head there. It's a great movie. Anybody, check out Black Dynamite if you have not seen it. It's fantastic.
You diabolical, dick-shrinking motherfucker.
Hey, my mama said my daddy's name Black Dynamite, too.
That's funny.
That movie has so many great moments, and I highly recommend you people check that out. Terrence, give us a recommendation.
Hey, what do you mean by you people? All right, I'd like to say in closing, man, we had an incredible week last week. We had over 3,000 plays, and it's absolutely amazing. But what I'd like to see out of you guys, because obviously you're loving the show, but come to the Facebook page, either that or I know I can tell maybe some of you don't want to sign up on Podbean to leave comments because you don't want to be pestered for 2 minutes to fill out your fucking info. But you can click on the fucking Facebook page. That's the picture of the devil. Come on there and talk to us. We want to talk. We want to figure out what you guys like, what you don't like. We want to talk to the fans. You know, we want to make this the best show we can. Well, mostly for me, but for you too. And for Ralph, you know, nobody cares what Terrence wants. Well,
shut the fuck up, asshole.
All right. But please, come on the Facebook page. We're going to let anybody join who wants to join. But talk to us. You know, if you want to tell us we suck, that's great. But interact with us. But thanks for listening, because we are doing amazing. We're on iTunes, Facebook. We are on YouTube. There's so many ways to enjoy this show. Well, probably the best way to enjoy it is with the sound off. But, you know, keep tuning in. Keep listening every Sunday. New episodes. Thank you so much.
Fuck sports. That's all I got to say. I hate sports. But it's cool that you guys like it. But let that be the last sports mention on the Rock and Metal Podcast.
And I concur.
And, okay. And Ian, you are a fan of the Raiders, right?
Yes.
Okay, I'll tell you this. I like the pirate. I like the image of the Raiders, but this is the only time I'm going to talk about sports, and that's it. I'm never going to discuss sports again.
Deal.
What do the Raiders and the post office have in common?
Neither one delivers on Sunday, you unoriginal piece of shit. Jesus Christ.
Thank you. Thank you.
That's funny, Ralph. That was a good one.
I saw that online, and I thought it'd be it. I actually had an ex-girlfriend that loved the Raiders, and I would watch it with her, but she ended up cheating on me, so fuck her, and fuck the Raiders, and fuck you.
Yeah, I know, we get penalties all the time for cheating. It sucks.
Yeah, exactly. She was too much of a Raiders fan, if you know what I mean.
So, all right, you still have her number.
Dude, I would not wish her even on you, dude.
Ooh, that's bad.
Yeah, exactly. anyway, so I want to thank everybody that's listening and what Ian said. I am going to spoil it for everybody. Next week, we are going to talk about Queen. Well, I won't say what album it is. Don't say the album. I'm just going to keep it quiet. We are going to discuss a Queen album, but the week after that, we're actually going to have on the show a fan of the podcast. So there's somebody that likes the Rock and Metal podcast that we're going to bring on the show. Now, I'm not saying everybody that likes it, we're going to put you on the show. But this guy, we're going to put on the show for a special reason. And that reason, you will find out 2 weeks from now. And I just want to say, again, thank you, everybody out there that listens to us. And I didn't discuss an album like these two dudes, and I still won't, but I do want to give a plug to a band from South Florida called Necromaniac, which is spelled with K's, like N-E-K-R-O-M-A-N-I-K, Maniac, you know. And look them up on Facebook, add them, check them out. I really love that band. They're my buds, you know, and it kind of sucks, you know. It's like, they've been my friends forever, and they formed the band, and the band kicks ass. And I, you know, and I really hope they are genuine. Like they think I'm genuine, because believe me, if they sucked, I wouldn't be plugging them now. They actually are really good. So check out Necromaniac. They kick ass. They're from South Florida. And check out my new band. We're called Combat. Yeah, for a second, I forgot the name of my band. And we debuted 2 days ago. We went over really good. People fucking loved it. And gives me good hope for the future. And add us, please, on Facebook as well. And don't forget to add the Rock and Metal Combat Podcast. We want to talk to all of you. And hey, if you're entertaining enough, we might even put you on the show too. But you have to have an angle. You have to, like, all three of us go, hey, man, let's get this guy on the show. He seems like he'll be entertaining. And those that we don't put on the show, and we still like, please don't get offended by it. I mean, we're putting this guy on for an angle. Anyway, that's me, Dr. Fuck, signing off. Good night, everybody. Bye, Terrence. Bye, Ian.
Hail Satan.
Bye.